obviously impact on this, but in all likelihood, what are you going to say to your players with regards to toning down goal celebrations to maintain social distance?
That we just try it. I know exactly how it is. I played myself. It's a difficult one, but we all know about the situation. And the boys did so far an incredible job to be disciplined with all the things we had to do around that virus and pandemic. And I know they will try to do their best, but it will be, if there's hopefully something to celebrate, that it will be in an appropriate way. But it's difficult, and with all the things going around, we just have to. It's like others said before. It's instinct. So it's really difficult. And if you, when you run alone towards a goal, and so I have the opportunity to score, and in the next situation you have to think about what you do then. That's just, it's a proper challenge, honestly. And football is an emotional game, and all these things. What we should not forget in the discussion about this is that these players are two or three times tested a week. So during the week we reduce the contact to a minimum. With all the measure, with all the things we have to do in the training ground, these are the moments once, twice, three times a week where they have to concentrate mainly on the game, on the things they have to do. And we will see. We will try how we always did. That's it.
It will be your 200th game with Liverpool, and tonight, ahead of that, I know you're raising money for the Alzheimer's Society as well with Sir Kenny Dalglish and Sir Alex Ferguson, so I'm sure the rivalry with United will crop up at some point as well. But what extra edge is there when they can obviously move 6 points clear of you at the top of the table, or you can go back to the top of the table by taking all 3 points yourselves?
Winning a football game and being a winning against United, it's enough. Itself, so there's not necessary that there's a special add-on. So we play at home against United and we want to win, so that's all we have to think about. It's, and there's no extra add-on in that game, because they're in the situation they are. They got the points, they deserve the points they have so far, and we have ours, and the season is still a long way to go, so it's not really in it that we talk now constantly about if we win, we are ahead of them again, and then they are blah, blah, blah. And how it looks at the moment with all how the football they play again, Man City is one game behind and is very close as well. So you have constantly to think about other teams. We don't do that. We just try to win our football games, and for this we need to perform on our highest level, because United is good. They always were. And that's it.
How likely is it you'll have Joel Matip available? And if there is a doubt, have you decided whether or not you'll drop Jordan Henderson back there again as a contingency plan?
Joel is close. Does it make sense now to throw him in a game with one or two sessions, which he didn't do yet, but today and tomorrow he might be involved. To bring him, I don't know. We have to see how we have to decide it then. You have to look at him, how he will train and how he looks in training, these kind of things. But we have still different solutions, and Hendo is for us very important in midfield as well. So, we just have to see. But it's not decided yet. Why should I?
Mandy, Premier League Productions, and then we'll go to James Mountford, then Ian from TalkSport, and Carl Markham from the Press Association. Mandy.
Hi, Jürgen. I just wondered how impressed you've been with the work that Marcus Rashford has done in recent months and still continues to do.
I think I said it before, it's absolutely exceptional what Marcus is doing there. He's rightly so really got some reward for that, like some honors. I don't know exactly what they all got, but it's absolutely right. It's a little bit, and I know Marcus sees it the same, a little bit of shame that he has to do the work, that it's not self-understanding that these kind of things happen, but he did it because he saw the issue, because he had the same situation when he was a kid. So, and it's just great when you see somebody never forgetting his roots, and it's exceptional thing to do.
On the pitch, Bruno Fernandes has had a huge impact on Manchester United. From afar, do you think that he's been the biggest thing to change the way they've played in recent months?
He's an outstanding player. We played before he joined United. We played against Sporting in USA on a tour. And in that game already, you could see, wow. And obviously, everybody knew him. But in that game, the first time I played against, my team played against a team he was involved, you could really see he's a difference maker, and that's what he shows now. And it's settled. He's a very influential player for United, obviously involved in a lot of things. I know people talk mostly about the goal involvements, which is very important stuff, but he's a link up in a lot of other situations as well. Don't know him well enough to really can judge that, but he seems to be a leader as well. So yeah, good signing, unfortunately, for United.
Thank you. James Mountford from BBC, and then we'll go to Ian from Talkport. James.
Hi, Jürgen. Good afternoon. It's already been mentioned it's going to be your 200th league game for Liverpool tomorrow. It'll be your 100th league game at Anfield. Of 99 so far, you've only lost four. Just how proud are you of that incredible record?
Not at all, because I never thought about it, and I cannot get now proud in that second. So it looks like an okay record, but who cares about this record if we don't win the next one? So that's our life, and that's how I see it. So I'm not in for a second in the past. So far so good. We have to carry on, we have to get better, and that's all what we try. It feels like I had much more games. It's only 200, but it's a good number as well. And so yeah, all okay, but nothing to really think about.
Just on the injury front, in addition to Joel Matip, Naby Keita, how ready is he for the game, please?
No, not. Naby's not ready for involvement. Not a big thing, but it's a little bit like with other players in the past, like when they came back from injuries, and then they, because of the amount of games, because of the situation in the squad, they had to play, then a little injury happened again. So now we had just to put in the break and say, come on, now we have really, let's settle it properly. In a moment, we have alternatives in midfield, and so we really try to give him all the time he needs to get 100% fit, and that's the situation. So no, he's not in contention for Sunday.
Okay, thank you, James. Ian from TalkSport.
Can I just go back to the goal celebrations, the social distancing and the protocols? I mean, In your opinion, how close are we, if players don't get this right, to maybe losing watching football and having the health, mental health that the football brings?
Well, it's a difficult question to answer, only because of you all make the wrong things of it. Whatever I say, you make big stories of it, and it's like we nobody uses, and it's, I understand it completely, but in this moment nobody uses really common sense anymore. So if we, in this moment in time, we all wish we would know more about this virus, but we get information step by step by step, and we play now football, right, like, I'm not sure, but 6-7 months in the pandemic, if I'm right, maybe not, maybe it's less. I don't know exactly, but we play for a while. In these games, during goal celebrations, as far as we scored a few goals, in that time, nothing happened. So, and I know there are different things to talk about. One is the role model we should be, but we, how I said, we get tested 2 or 3 times. Since it started, again, we got tested always 2 times, sometimes 3 times a week, because of international things. Even when the Premier League said 1 time is enough, then we had still 2 times a week because of the Champions League. So we feel, but we know, between the tests, there are still 2 days or whatever where you could get infected and stuff like that. And it happened. it happened. We had cases, most of them, we had pretty much all of them had when people left the bubble. So that's true as well. I mean, for private reasons, for international duties, and all of a sudden they came back and had the virus. In our situation now here, it never spread. So it never spread because we always, even when we all get tested, we still are distanced in the dressing rooms, in the thing. So the only thing where the it looks like kind of normal, even when we people are in the stadium apart from the players and a few people from media, it was the only moment where we try to forget this stuff. If somebody says now that something what is from a role model point of view, because some people might think, oh, they can hug each other, why I can't hug? And we have, of course, a problem, but I think people are smart enough to make the difference between people who are constantly tested and you are not tested, so that makes a massive difference. If we would think and feel that we threaten one or two of our teammates, we never would do it. Nothing, it would just not happen. But it's the only safe place we had, only out there on the pitch, outside, what people said from the beginning, it's not as infectious and all that stuff. Inside, nothing like this happens. We have team meetings in rooms, and I have to shout. They are that big that the players can understand me. And so I understand the discussion, and I have no real solution, but if somebody says now we have to stop the game because of that and cause then other issues, which I'm sure that would happen in a society with, because I really think, meanwhile, it's proven how important that the football is in this moment in time. And it's really tough. I know it's much tougher things, but it's really tough for the boys to like this. Our building is the whole day cold because all doors are open. Everybody walks through here in warm coats. We try absolutely everything. We had to close the canteens and all these kind of things. So it's everything. There's no point during a week where you can create kind of a group feeling with the boys, because what you usually would do is, oh, come on, come together, let's talk about this and how we get out and get stronger. It's absolutely not there. So all really important things in all the on a daily basis. We can't do it, so we don't do it. We don't sneak in a room and now nobody sees us. Nothing, that never happens. So we just stick to the rules. And if now somebody says, if you do this again, then we have to stop the game, I wouldn't understand, to be honest. But I'm not the decision maker. I cannot make the decisions. We follow the rules. We try everything. That's what I said in the beginning. But it's nothing happened around goal celebrations. Some are good examples. Only last week when we played against Southampton, it's a good example with Danny. And I don't say that's 100% sure, but again, I said we try. But if somebody wants to stand now there and says, oh, they are too close, now we have to go. It's not right. And again, if we deliver, apart from some entertainment, something, then it's as well that if you get tested often enough, but we all said from the beginning, we have to test as often as we can. If you get tested often enough, if you stick to the rules, then you are not that much in danger like you would without getting tested and without sticking to the rules. You can still do some stuff what is possible, like, let me say, sports outside or these kind of things. Nothing happens there. I understand that the rules have to be strict, because if you don't put out strict rules, the society is not disciplined enough to say, okay, then they said you can stay at home or you can go out, then we all know what happens. So I understand 100% that the rules have to be strict, but we have to learn from the things they've worked in the past, now in the past few months as well, and football worked. Increased number of cases. It was always clear that the winter will be a challenge because people are more inside, and it was always clear that Christmas will be a challenge for the society as well. Both happened, but now being surprised that it happened, and it's just not right. I know people work tirelessly on solutions, and I don't have them, but what I have is experience in some situation during a week, what works and what doesn't work. That doesn't work for the whole outside world, but in a football environment, most of the things happen. And that's all really I can say about that.
Thank you, Ian. And we'll finish the open section with Carl from Press Association. Sorry, we can get to everyone who's got their hands up, and then we will go to the embargo section. Carl Markham.
Hi, Jürgen.
Hi, Carl.
Hi. I don't know, it surprises you that your comments about penalties compared Liverpool and Man United is still generating debate even now. We've had former referees chipping in on it, and today we've got Marcus Rashford saying that when Mourinho was manager at United, he told him he needed to be more streetwise in terms of winning penalties. I'm just wondering, have you ever said anything similar to any of your players at any point? I mean, we've had, you know, people like Mohamed Salah being criticised for, you know, not making the most of it or making too much of it. Or
nope. I can 100% honest and never mentioned something like this to any player I have worked together with. I've worked with a lot of players, so if you have time, ask all of them. It never happened. So that's it. Am I surprised that somebody's talking about what I said after the Southampton game? No, I'm not. Am I surprised that Mark Clattenburg speaks about it? No, I'm not sure what if he got asked a lot of things. Meanwhile, long after his career, so it's nice for him that we can talk about him as well. So I'm not. But I'm not Sir Alex. And for different reasons, when he said he tried something and mind games, I was directly after Southampton game in this moment, between this game and the United game, we had another game, and I didn't think a second about the United game in that moment. But before this game against Southampton, I saw the stats about the penalties, and that's what I mentioned in that. When people like Mark Gladenberg now speaking like they speak, it always says much more about them than it could ever say about me. So if he would be in my situation, he obviously would play mind games. I'm unfortunately not. I have no skills for playing mind games. That's my problem.
So in terms of players' reaction, you're just happy for the natural course of events to play out, and whatever comes of it, comes of it.
How long do we play now behind closed doors in a pandemic? How long do we play? How long is that? It's 5 months. So and now we come up with this. I know there's a new strain of the virus and the numbers went up,
I think Carl's talking about penalties. Is that right?
No, sorry. Yeah, what I'm saying was, you know, you're happy for the natural course of events in terms of the action of play, in terms of penalties, just to take their course, because we've had cases in the past where Mo's been fouled or Spears been fouled, not gone down, not got a penalty. So I'm telling you, you're happy for that just to play out as it does, without telling players they need to make sure they get a penalty.
I mean, we just didn't speak about it. So there were two situations, I think, in the last two games. Sadio Mane had a foul situation, which is a penalty for me, but it's not important because I cannot whistle, but I have to say my opinion. There was the handball. There was another situation where Sadio didn't go down. And now that's why I said, when people still say he's a diver or whatever, it's just not right. The game before against Newcastle, I think it was against Newcastle, we had pictures where the goalie sit on the ground and has both arms around Sadio Mane's legs. So he didn't go down, he tries to score the goal. So I didn't tell him, why didn't you go down? We didn't speak about it. Sadio knows that if Sadio gets fouled, he goes down. So, and that's how it is. And if not, then not, obviously. And that's the situation. So, yes, it is natural. And it's not about that. It's not the player who should make the decision, will that be a penalty or not? It's the ref who should make the decision. And after the Southampton game, when you saw it the next day, pretty much the only thing I really read, just to try to understand how people are living on another planet, obviously, like me, how they see it, the situation, and then was the handball, was no handball, and the Sadio Mane thing. So I think his name is Mr. Dermot, also the ref watch, and then he said that was no handball, and the other thing was not a penalty as well. And you think, okay, obviously I'm wrong, and they are always right. So it's just a situation. I don't want penalties who are no penalties, which are no penalties. I don't want. But if there's a penalty, it would be nice if they whistle it because it's part of the game. That's all.